Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Feliz Sabada. Getting a little ringing up here. We'd like to welcome you to Highland View. Students, adults, visitors, members. We'd like to begin our service. We're right on Brazilian time, which is about 10 minutes after 11.
Amen.
Let's enter into a word of prayer. We'd like to pray, and then Jerome's going to take a minute and sort of make sure you guys know our first song, because it's a song designed to invite God to take our hearts, which I think is a great way to start a worship service. We want to take everything that may be surrounding your life right now or giving you anxiety or issues, and we just want to push it out to the side, right?
Amen.
And enter into this hour of worship. So let's bow our heads. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to come and praise your name and to invite your spirit to touch each heart. May you be with each person here, Lord, and guide us in our service and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Here's my heart, O Lord. Here's my heart, O Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Let's stand if we can, and let's open up our hearts up to Jesus. He loves us so much, he died on the cross for us. So let's give God praise. Everything that hath breath, let's praise the Lord. Hallelujah. If you have breath, praise the Lord. If you're dead, you're not here, so you're not able to praise the Lord. And the Bible says the dead has dead is dead, right? Asleep, so you're not asleep, so let's praise God.
Yes. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. My heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. I am found. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure. I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart. My heart, Lord, is my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I am pure, I have.
You may be seated.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. What a wonderful Sabbath morning. I'm very happy to see you here, to have a good number of people, students, everyone. It's wonderful. And I'm especially happy this morning because I met one of the former pastors here, Pastor Sergio Manente. He's here this morning. He came for some commitments for the weekend, and I asked Jim to invite him to preach, and I appreciate your willingness to preach for us this morning. I was talking to him. He said that he pastored HVC for almost 7 years, right? 6.5 years before Pastor Caesar, and it's always good to meet old friends. So yeah, thank you so much for being here with us. And he told me about his Italian roots. And by the way, I want to try your pasta. Do you cook? Okay. We need to check this out. And since Italia is not playing in the World Cup, we came to an agreement that he will cheer for Brazil this World Cup. Okay? Sounds good. Oh, no. Please, no. Thank you so much. All right, I have 3 short announcements of important events that will take place in the next couple of days, okay? Number 1, we are having our second gathering for our hiking club today. That's very exciting. So we will meet at Burnside Bridge. If you have any questions, you can ask that gentleman. Say hi to us, Paul. Okay, this is Paul. He is in charge of the trail we will do. Okay, we have 2 options of trails that we will leave from the same point and get to the same point, a shorter version and a longer version. Okay, so you are welcome to join us. We had 20 people last time. We had a great time together, and someone asked me, yesterday, can I bring my dog with me? Yes, dogs are welcome, and bring a leash. Make sure to you bring your leash, and your dog is welcome as well. Tomorrow we are going to have senior class yard sale and car wash. Is that right, seniors? Okay, so from 8 through 2 p.m. right? Okay, from 8 through 2 p.m. Let's bring our dirty cars and help our seniors. And 3rd and last announcement, tomorrow morning, we have a special event hosted by Women's Ministry. So tomorrow at 10, right? 10:30. Is that right, Yucabeth? 10:30, tomorrow morning in the fellowship hall. And we will have this special event with all women invited. And then when they finish the event, they will tell you something about the special event that they're planning every quarter that will take place in December, okay? So please be here for this special activity. Thank you so much. And I also, yes. Okay, so the hike today is at 3:30 at the meeting point. So last time we met here in the church parking lot, but this time we're meeting at the place. So it's Burnside Bridge. You received the midweek update, and there's the meeting point there. But if you for some reason you didn't get your midweek update, the newsletter, Paul has some directions he printed out. So you just look for him and ask him for a copy, and he will be glad to offer you one. Okay, thank you so much, and I'd like to thank especially our praise team. We have a wonderful praise team this morning, and I will ask Jim to introduce the team later. Thank you.
Was their dad. They lived with their dad, and their dad was very rich. And they all helped their dad in his field to take care of the pigs, you know, the cows and the goats and the monkeys, and you know, he helped them with that. And then one day the younger son was like, "Oh, dad, I want my share of like everything that I've done. I want my money so I can go and I can leave you." And his dad obviously was very confused, and why do you want to do that? But you know, he gave him the money and then he went. So he went to the city, and you know, he spent all the money, he went to the movies, he went to the parks, like he was just on his own, and he was like spending the money on people that are not his friends. So he finally squandered all his money, he finished his money and he had nothing left, he was living on the streets. And so he had to go find a job. And he was living with this person and the person told him to go stay with the pigs, you know, in the mud and all that, and that was really dirty. And one day he was there with the pigs, and he was eating with the pigs, and he was like, wow, this isn't who I am. And so he left, and then he went back to his father, and then he was very, you know, remorseful. He was sorry that, you know, he went against, like, his dad's will, and he wasn't being a good guy. He wasn't representing his dad well. So he went back to his father, and luckily for him, his father accepted him with open arms. And then his older brother was like, that is not fair. You are accepting him. And then his father actually threw a party because he came back. And his brother was like, Dad, it's not fair. You're throwing a party because he came back. That's not fair because I've been here and I've been helping you. And his father was like, he's still my son. And so this parable was able to teach us that no matter how far we go, no matter where we go, no matter how many wrongs we've done, the Lord will still accept you. So whether you stole a candy or something and you think, oh, I've done a bad thing, just go back to God and ask him for forgiveness and he will accept you. So that's the story for today.
Dear Jesus, you heard us. Amen.
All right, you guys can go back to your seats.
Okay, it's time for the praise team again, and Bruno set me up to do an introduction. It's really fun today because I get to play with my two sons. My oldest son, Jason, back on the drums, and Joel, my youngest son, is on bass. These guys are both degreed musicians, so they're way better than their dad, which is why they don't play with me so often. We were in a praise team here years ago because they're both Highland View Academy alumni. And our band was called the Time of Trouble Band. But our lead guitar player used to call us the Trouble with Timing Band. And they've moved on, and now they know how to keep time, but I'm still back there. And then I'd like to introduce Josh Irvin. Good boy. I often said when Josh was here years ago and played with us, he's my adopted son. Very talented. I helped him get that guitar that he's playing today, right? Yeah. And he's coming out of retirement. How long has it been since you played? He hasn't played live in 6 years. So we're going to keep inviting him back, Bruno, because I find you need a reason to play, to keep playing. So that's our team. And of course, Jerome, who I often draft Jerome. If I see him come in the door, I say, you're singing today. Right?
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Fortunately, he's good enough to pull that off. Okay, we're going to do Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. It's upbeat, and we tried to pick songs that would work with the drums and the bass. Here we go.
If you're able to stand, let's all stand and give God some praise. He's worthy to be praised. Give him praise. The dead can't give God any praise. The dead knows nothing, so let's give God some praise.
Stand and lift up our hands.
For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. And together we sing. Everyone sing.
Praise Him, the rocks would praise Him, guys. So we better give Him praise. He's worthy. He's more than worthy to be praised. Amen. Jesus. What a beautiful name. The name of Jesus. Everybody just say, Jesus. Oh, you guys are sleeping. Let's say, Jesus. Let's say louder again, Jesus. A little louder. You're breathing out there? Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. He's worthy. He's worthy. Do you want the rocks to cry out, or do you want to sing?
The word from the beginning, that the God was Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name. Jesus Christ, our King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
Heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name
every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. Hallelujah. What a beautiful name it is. It's a powerful name. Say Jesus one more time. Jesus. Jesus. Amen.
Death could not hold. Jesus. powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. It's the name of Jesus.
Jesus, we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
There are probably no lyrics for this song. If you know it, sing along with us. It wasn't going to be here in this order, but we've kind of shuffled things around today for a bunch of reasons.
Thank you.
So listen to our hearts, hear our spirit sing the song of praise and love for the Lord you have redeemed. We will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. The words are not enough to tell you our love. So listen to us. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
And I wanted to read a verse to you. You must each decide in your heart how much to give, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. Deacons, can you please come down? And I'm going to say a little prayer. Precious Father, thank you so much for the bountiful blessings that you give us every single day. Please be with us as we figure out how much to give back to you. In your sweet and holy name I pray, amen.
Time for the garden of prayer, and I need this stand this morning. You'll understand why in a moment, but basically my prayer concentrates on parents this morning, but if you're one that's reaching out to someone special or a neighbor or a relative, and you've been praying for them for a long time, and you don't see any changes, or you don't see the things that you want to see, it doesn't mean that God doesn't see it, but it means you don't. I want to give you some encouragement. September the 13th was my 80th birthday. On September the 18th, we celebrated it. It was hard for me to agree with my wife to have this party because I just really don't believe in celebrating a birthday like that with a lot of people. But I said, okay. And there were to be no gifts. That was in the invitations that were sent out. And we basically invited people that have been friends of ours or acquaintances of ours for a lengthy time, for a long time, and family. But people came with gift cards, and I appreciate that. But there's one gift that I'll keep forever. I'll probably have it laminated, but it was from my oldest son. And I'm going to read it to you the best I can. And he writes, Shelley, Sean, and I hope that you enjoyed your birthday. And we hope you enjoy the gift card to Dick's Sporting Goods. The amount only reflects your age and a number. And with that card, you can purchase something that is always reflecting your young heart. The other gift reflects the type of father you have been over the years. You have raised and nurtured two men that reflect you as we journey through our chapters in life as fathers and husbands. This picture of Todd and I is my way of showing so much appreciation from me for you. You have shown nothing but love and support through the years. Although sometimes tough love is the best love, and I appreciate that chapter in my life. From the time you entered my life, you have been there. Through my birthdays, stumbles in life, health issues, athletics, career steps, and an unwavering support for me no matter what. Your steps in life have raised a man that values his son and wife, a man that tries to walk in the same steps of your word in life is all you have, and to treat others as you wish to be treated. You have embedded character in me that is a tough word to completely define, but it reflects you. Words will truly never reflect my love for you, but the memories will. My goal is to continue to live my life in this manner. I hope you enjoy this moment in life and enjoy many more. Tom. You know, we go through life as parents, wondering if our kids hear us, if they even acknowledge it. I hope that every mother and father, if you don't receive a letter like this sometime in your life, that one of your children will sit down with you and express these same thoughts. this letter not only made me feel proud, but it drew me closer to God, because they do hear, and that has been part of my talk with him many times. Why should I bother? You know, they're not going to do it. They don't hear. They do see, and they do hear. Just because you don't see it right now doesn't mean that they're not trying the best they can to walk in the example that we provide. Continue to do what you're doing. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for family. Lord, help us to continue to just reach out to others and reflect you for all that you have done in our lives. You have shown us the way, Lord. Help us to present you to the others, to be the witness that you have called us to be. Lord, thank you for this church family. Thank you for their faithfulness. Lord, continue to walk with them and encourage them each and every day. Thank you for another day of life. Thank you for the Sabbath. And thank you for loving us more than we'll ever understand. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
While we have our choir coming up here, I would like to introduce to you this new ministry in our church. That's the first time we are singing together as a church choir. And I would like you to feel welcome to join us in our next times or next performances. It's not just about singing and praise the Lord together, but it's about to get together and know each other and share time together and build our a community praising and around the Lord. Today we are going to sing a song based on Philippians 4:13 that says, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I hope you're blessed by this message.
Good morning, church. It is good to be here. It's good to be back. I know I see some familiar faces, but I also see a bunch of new faces. And it's good to be here. It's great to hear the choir sing. I feel like you guys did that just for me. It's the first time. Nice. I appreciate that very much. It's great to see students here. Great to see you guys. Some old friends, some young friends, and those in between. It's great to be here. I'm here for a wedding, which is actually tomorrow night, but I thought, why not? Why not come out here and spend some time with my friends here at Highland View Church? I really appreciate it. I really appreciate Jim and Pastor Bruno and, inviting me and to be part of this, and I'm thankful for that. So I'm just going to get going right away here. I'm really just honored that I could be here with you guys. So I'm going to start with this question here. You ever wonder if you ever got arrested, where you would be, what prison you'd go to? Yeah? No? Nobody? Nobody ever thought about that? I've done some research, and there's a prison in Norway. It's called Norway's Halden Prison, and that's the prison room right there. Now, I know, students, you're thinking, man, my dorm room is not even that nice, right? I mean, that is nice. That is, I mean, if I was going to go to prison, I'd want to go to prison there. That's the place that I'd want to be at. However, you know, and this is, what's great about this place is that it's actually, it's what they consider the most humane prison. Inmates can make music there. It's kind of cool. They could do woodworking. They can cook their own food. Oh, yeah. Prepare for their life outside. It's kind of a nice thing to do, right? But the words we're about to read this morning, they actually echo from a cold, dark chamber hidden beneath the streets of first century Rome. The Apostle Paul is there. The walls have this thick black stones, musty and gray and grimy, some blood stained from prisoners of old. The cold winds have no resistance through those lazy walls. It's a whole different experience than the Norway prison, wouldn't you say? And isolated, surrounded only by a dim torch light of a dancing flame, the Apostle Paul, lonely, shivering, with his young friend Timothy by his side, is writing a letter, and he's writing a letter to some friends that you guys just sang about in Philippi. Some friends in Philippi, and he's trying to encourage them, and he's hoping that they get this letter. This is a church plant. This is a church that he planted some years before that. The rattle of the rusty chains have almost become a familiar sound. He writes, knowing that his days are numbered. But he's writing to encourage those who have been encouraging him all along. And as you read the letter, and we don't have time to go through the whole letter, I'm just going to focus on one sentence actually today. But as you read the letter, he highlights several themes that encourage, that challenge, that edify. Undeniably, however, the greatest theme, believe it or not, in the letter of the Philippi is joy. That's like the best theme. 16 times he mentions joy in the letter to the Philippi. 16 times. I love what C.S. Lewis says. He says, joy is the serious business of heaven. Isn't that awesome? Joy is the serious... Are you guys alive out there? Just make sure. Okay. Joy, thank you. Yes. Joy is the serious business of heaven. I love that. I don't know about you, but whenever people talk about God and they talk about being in prison. Not, joy is not one of the... But here's the guy who is in this prison. Here's the guy that's totally surrounded by chains and darkness. And yet, his greatest theme in this place is joy. Wow. I don't know. Paul is in a dungeon speaking of joy as if he's in a Norwegian prison. As if he is just kind of relaxing, doing his thing. Now, if we go back to Acts chapter 16, it speaks of when Paul was a free man and he was planting this church in Philippi. After receiving a vision to bring good news to the people in Macedonia, in fact, there was actually times when God was closing doors. He wanted to go somewhere else, and God said no. He finally gets this vision. He wants to go to this place in Macedonia, and Philippi was there. This was a Roman city at the time, built and fortified by a guy by the name of Philip, thus Philippi, right? He was the father of Alexander the Great, and it was 350 years before Christ. It was founded on Roman law, Roman culture, and practice. 8 miles from the sea, Philippi became a strategic stopping place for all kinds of Roman merchants, Roman army. And there, he, Paul, and his buddy Silas, as they're church planting, deciding what do we do, where do we do this here, he meets a woman by the name of Lydia, a respected, courageous believer. And this church becomes one of the first progressive churches of the Bible, where women lead as well as men. Amen? At least from the women. Like, can I get a man from there? He baptizes Lydia. And then they go out, do some more stuff. I don't have the time to tell the whole story, but they get into trouble. He and Silas get thrown into jail in Philippi. And they're there, and if you know the story, it's really awesome because they're there in the jail in Philippi, and he and Silas begin to sing hymns. Hey, what is wrong with Paul? I mean, I don't know. I think maybe sometimes he's missing something, right? Because now he's in a jail in Philippi, and he's singing hymns. He and Silas are singing hymns. And while he's singing hymns, there's an earthquake. The doors go. I mean, it's unbelievable what is happening here. He's in jail. Of course, now the jailer wants to commit suicide. He can't have them run away. Paul stops him. The next thing you know, he's doing Bible studies with the jailer and his family, and he baptizes them, and they become part of the new plant church in Philippi. I don't know about you, but that just blows my mind. That is just unbelievable to me. It was becoming increasingly obvious that the Christian church was on the move, that their mission could not be foiled, their character could not be soiled, their determination could not be spoiled. When they came to town, religious leaders and Roman soldiers trembled. The incredible power of assurance, the awesome display of God's power, attractive, magnetic. Paul and Silas representing the church, demonstrating strength and absolute security. Character deeper, their spirit softer, their courage greater, their integrity is higher. It is an unbelievable experience. The compassion is unmatched and the conviction is unshakable. I wonder what has happened to God's church these days. Do we have that same level of conviction? Do we have that same ability, that same confidence, that same joy? I think some do. As they continued to be considered dangerous to an upside-down, broken-hearted, money-hungry, sin-addicted culture. Sounds familiar? And sin, Satan redoubles his efforts to shut Paul away for good in a Roman dungeon. And that's where we are now. We're in this dungeon with Paul and Timothy as he's writing this letter, this personal letter that is recorded for all of us to be able to read in response to the gifts sent to Paul while in prison by the people in Philippi. There's a guy by the name Epaphroditus, which I'm just going to call Frodo from now on, if that's okay with you. And he takes this stuff to Paul, and he takes ill, and he's about to die. Frodo's about to die, but through prayer and supplication and healing, he recovers, and it's unbelievable what happens as he brings back the letter to them. Back in those days, by the way, I know this is hard to believe, but there were no emails, no texts. You got a letter, you wrote a letter, you sent the letter, and you hope the letter got there. You hope somebody got there with the letter. And the letter starts off with this, like, grace and peace be to you. I thank God every day for who you are and how you treat me. And can I be honest with you? This is absolutely true. I am thankful for the church I'm at. And it's the only church that is like this church. I boast about this church all the time. This is the church that has always been a very loving, accepting, non-judgmental church. Church that has energy with students. Church that has season and wisdom. I mean, this is an awesome church. And I thank God every day for the years that I got to spend at this church. And I know there are some of you here that know exactly what I'm talking about. This church has got some real, real stuff going on, and I love that. Pastor Bruno, you're in a great place right now. And you are loved by some great people. He continues as he writes. And then he writes these words. And these are the words that I really want to concentrate on for a little bit. He says this. Being confident of this. Being confident of this. That he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Being confident of this. What are you confident in these days? I think the longer the world goes, the less confidence we have. And yet here is Paul in a dungeon, and he is speaking of joy, and he is speaking of confidence, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. I had a friend many years ago. He was like a cousin to me, actually. His name was Michael. He and I grew up together. But Michael grew up in a rough situation. His parents divorced, and I kind of lost connection with Michael, especially as I turned to Christ in my life. And it wasn't until years later that I found Michael again, and Michael was a crack addict at the time. And my daughter Brianna at the time was only like 1 year old, and we'd have Michael come over because Michael was the only one that could put Brianna to sleep. You know, just shaking the whole time. And she can go to sleep. That was great, you know. And so I was trying to minister to Michael and see what I could do. And I remembered that he loved fishing. And so I decided, let me take you fishing, man. Let's go. I lived in New Rochelle, New York at the time. I said, let me take you fishing. We'll go and to Hudson Park. And we'll row out to Echo Island together. And we'll go fishing together. We'll talk and we'll pray. And Michael's like, oh, really? You would do that? Absolutely. Well, in fact, I'll pay for it right now. I called the place, paid for the boat, ready to go. I said, I'll meet you there, 8 o'clock in the morning. He's like, man, really? Yes, let's do it. And I go there, 8 o'clock in the morning, he's not there. 8:30, he's not there. 9 o'clock, he's not there. I realize Michael is not going to show up. and I'm too cheap to just lose the money. So I decide I'm going to get in the boat, and I'm going to row out to Echo Island, and I'm going to do my own fishing, my own praying, my own time with God. And so I, quite honestly, not really much of a rower, but I was shocked how easy it was to row out to Echo Island. I was like, man, this is, I don't know why people make a big deal about this, man. This is so easy. I'm out there, I'm trying to, I don't catch anything, but I do have a great time praying and everything. And time, it's getting hot, and decide I'm going to row back. And I get in the boat, and I launch it, and I jump in, and I start rowing. And I notice something, that as I'm rowing, I am in the same spot. And I'm like, is there an anchor or something I don't know about? What is going on here? And so I keep rowing and rowing and rowing. And it realized what was going on. You guys, some of you are way ahead of me. I know this. But what happened was that the current was in my favor when I rowed out to Echo. But the current was against me when I was trying to get home. What's your confidence like when the current is against you? See, I had confidence rowing out to Echo Island. Let me tell you what that confidence is called. That confidence is reckless, abandoned, ignorant confidence. That's when you're young and you think you can do it all, man. There's no problem at all. Let me get it. I got this. And you start rowing. Oh, yeah, no problem at all. I had confidence. But now suddenly I'm rowing back and I have no confidence because I am going nowhere. I am stuck in one place and going. And now motorboats going by. And I'm like, yeah, okay, you know, waving. And they're just going by. And I'm like, all right, you know, stop. Not so fast. Not so close. You know, you're going to push me back even further. And I'm just going. There was a buoy. I remember looking at that buoy. And it was always there. And it got, finally, my hands are blistered. And I'm thinking, God, what am I going to do now? Where your confidence comes from establishes its shelf life. Where do you get your confidence from? I remember praying there. I remember thinking about this one text, that he who began the good work will complete it. He who got me to Echo Island will get me back. And suddenly one motorboat with a kind man slows down. And he says to me, do you need any help getting back? And I said, let me think. Yes, I do. And the first thing he does, he opens up a cooler, takes out a soda pop, and he throws it to me. And I catch that. It was like slow motion. The first thing I did is I shook that, opened it in my face, and I just juggled it. It was so good. And then he throws me a rope, and I get that rope around me. And now he takes me all the way back to shore. All I kept thinking is that song, you know, Michael, Roll Your Boat Ashore. You know what I'm talking about? That's all I kept thinking. And this guy, his name was Michael. And he got me back. We live in a world that is insisting on convincing us that there is no such thing as being confident. We live in a world that is constantly trying to teach us the opposite. Let me illustrate. Go ahead and finish the following sentences. Don't count your chickens. Right. You can have your cake, or you can't have your cake. I needed to. It's too good to, if it's too good to be true, it's too good. It's not true. If it can go wrong, well, it's better to be safe. And so, yeah, see this? Look, we're so accustomed to this that we don't want to ever, ever get to the point where we have overconfidence. Quite honestly, though, as I meet people, confidence is not the problem. Most people are insecure. I never have to worry about people being arrogant. That's so rare, really. Most people really, even when they act arrogant, they're really, really deep down, they're very insecure. And when it comes to Jesus finishing his work in us, then that confidence goes really down. In fact, if I would have asked at the beginning, how many of you feel like you started a good journey with God, most of you would have been like, yeah, sure, you know, I was baptized, or yeah, I remember I was a kid, or whatever. You know, most of you would raise your hand. But if I would say to you, well, how many of you are confident that you're going to heaven, that you have eternal life, most of your hands would go down. Why? Because we struggle with having the confidence to be able to believe that Jesus, who began a good work in us, will complete it. Do you believe it? I don't know. I sure hope so. Confidence helps us to fight the voices that echo in our minds. I can never do that. I don't have what it takes. It's never been done before. What makes me think I can do it? I'm not good enough. I hear this all the time when I counsel with people. And the truth is, you can. I love this, and I'm going to mess it up, but it's a great quote. I believe it's by Ralph Waldo Emerson. It's something to the effect that goes like this, that if you move in the direction of your dreams, the universe will conspire with you. I believe that the being in that universe that will conspire with you is Jesus Christ. Amen? So out there in the open sea, okay, the Long Island Sound, whatever you want to call it, with blistered hands trying desperately to row against the current, being confident of this, that he who began a good work will get me home. So what are you confident about these days? Where does your confidence come from? See, the Apostle Paul here is writing about a confidence in God from a rat-infested, musty, drafty Roman dungeon. It doesn't add up. He's chained to a wall with just enough slack to move about. I mean, let's be honest. Even John the Baptist, who Jesus called the greatest of all men, got to the point where he lost confidence. And he said, hey, is this the real one? Or should we look for somebody else? I mean, I got to know. I'd rather have the confidence of Paul than to be called the greatest of all men. Can I be honest with you? You can call me the least of all people, but if I have Paul's confidence, I know I'm okay. So I came across some texts here that I want to share with you. The first one, of course, is in Psalm 27. This was King David, and he says these words, I remain confident of this. I remain confident of this. That means he's got it. He's going to keep it. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I remain confident of this. The next text is found, is the one we read just this morning, is being confident of this. So David says, I remain confident. Paul says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. And then just a few verses later, in that same letter, he says this. He says, and now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me actually served to advance the gospel. As a result of my chains, as a result of me being in prison, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. What an attitude. And then he says, I love this, and because of my chains, most brothers and sisters have what? Become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. Are you catching this? I love this. Paul is so confident of God's power to complete the work in each and every one of us that he says that even though some preach the gospel out of gain or envy, it doesn't matter, he says. The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached, and this I rejoice. Very important. Where does your confidence come from? There are those in this room right now that have had confidence all along. You've been doing great and you remain confident. I don't know how you do it, but God bless you. There are some of you in this room who are being confident. In other words, you realize this is a choice I have to make every single day of my life. I am being confident. And there are some of you right now who are becoming confident. I don't know where you are. I don't know which one you are. But I want to tell you something. Any one of those three, God's got your back. God is going to make sure that he who began a good work in you will complete it. He will do it. No matter where you think you are, no matter how far you think you are, if he began that work, he is committed to finishing it in your life. Do you believe it? I love what Zig Ziglar says. He says, confidence is going after Moby Dick in a rowboat and taking tartar sauce with you. I love that. Whether you are remaining confident, being confident, or becoming confident, the promise is the same. The goodness of God will complete the work you started until the day of Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but that's liberating. I don't have to work on completing the work. My only job is to become, to be, and remain confident. I'm going to say that again because I don't think you got it. My work will never be about completing the work. My work is to become, to be, and to remain confident in the one who can complete the work. So Pastor Bruno talked about Italy not being in the World Cup. I get it. And I'm still deciding. It's you know, I like Argentina too, just so you know. But you know, so but I know, I'm getting in trouble here. But I'm confident you stay with me on this one. 2006. Do you remember who won the World Cup in 2006? I could tell you. It was Italy. They were playing France. Now, I had watched every single game that Italy played, that, and I was like, this is, I couldn't believe it, that they had made it all the way to the World Cup. I was blown away by this. And then I had to do a wedding on the Sunday of the World Cup. So I text all my brothers and I say, please do not talk to me about the game. I don't want to know about the game. Don't text me about the game. I'm having somebody that's going to actually record it for me and I'm going to watch the game. I didn't know what's going to happen. France was definitely going to be the team to root for. They were the ones that were supposed to win. But I had confidence in Italy. And so now I'm at this wedding. My friend from New York came to Pennsylvania to be at the wedding and then also watch the game with me afterwards. We were so excited. And we're like, you know, here in Pennsylvania, nobody cares about football. I mean, the original football, you know what I'm talking about, right? Nobody cares about it. I'm not going to have to worry about it. It's going to be great. It's going to be, I'm not, you know, and so all my phone is shut off. I'm not listening to the radio, nothing. I'm telling my friends, please do not tell me. And we're there, and we're at the wedding, and we're there as long as we feel like we need to be there, you know? And we're just about to leave, and the best man decides he's going to do a toast. And Tony's like, well, let's listen to the toast. I'm like, all right, let's listen to the toast. So he gets up, and the very first words that come out of his mouth are, I don't know how many of you like soccer, but I just want you to know, And I'm like, no, don't tell me. Stop. And he says, Italy just won the World Cup. And I was like, great, but I didn't want to hear it. You know, and it was like, oh, no, why would you say this? You know, like, who are you? You don't even care about soccer. You don't even, why would you do, you're like Irish. You don't even know anything about, like, why are you doing this? Well, I went back and I watched the game. And as you watch the game, you know, France scores first. Italy scores, but it's, you know, it's a tie game. They go into overtime, and they go into shootout. And there's this big mess with one of the best players on the French. I mean, it's a wild game. And I'm thinking the whole time, now, I know Italy won. I was told Italy won by a reputable source. But I'm actually watching this game thinking, wow, did Italy win or not? I mean, like, and I'm watching this whole game, and it looks like we're going to lose. But deep down inside, I know we won. And I watch the game and finally gets to the penalty shots, and Italy, sure enough, does score enough to win the game. And just, even though I knew it, I still was like, yes, okay, yes. And then it dawned on me. Doesn't matter how you feel. If you know who wins and you're rooting for the right team, you can have all the confidence in the world that he who began a good work will complete it to the end. That he who got us going will finish it. Let me tell you something. You got to have that confidence. And I'll finish with this. When I was a teacher, an elementary school teacher, at Pearl River Elementary School, we had some circus trapeze artists come and do some of this kind of stuff. It was amazing to watch. Really, really loved it. And I was like shocked at what they could do. The way they could just jump and toss and they could like do somersaults through the air and then get caught on the other side was amazing. And then I talked to them afterwards and I said, how do you do it? Like, aren't you afraid you're going to fall? And like, I'll never forget what she said to me. She said, Mr. Manente, you do know that there is a net. Well, we have confidence that if anything would happen, the net's going to catch us. That's what I call net confidence. That makes sense. And then she said something else that was really, really important. I thought about this ever since as it comes to my walk with God. She said, the flyer must never catch the catcher. The flyer must wait in absolute confidence as she's flying through the air that the catcher will catch her. I want to encourage you to have that kind of confidence this morning that the catcher will catch you. That you can have absolute confidence that he who has begun a good work will finish it. So, let's be encouraged, as I'm sure the Philippi church was encouraged, to remain confident in the goodness of the Father. Amen? Amen. So we're going to sing right now about the Father's goodness, that we are never alone, his love is undeniable, his peace is unexplainable, and that he will finish the work until the day of Jesus Christ. Amen?
I didn't mention earlier, but Sergio is a drummer. And he actually helped us pick out this drum set, so my son agreed to let Sergio play on the last song. So we have a new drummer.
I'm not afraid to
Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Let us pray. Dear Father, thank you so much for the assurance you give us this morning, for this confidence that you got our back. Help us, Lord, to always remember that you are here for us and you will help us regardless of the circumstances. We praise your name for this important reminder this morning. We ask your anointings upon Pastor Manente as he performs this wedding ceremony and then he goes back to his church. May you continue to bless and use powerfully his ministry. Be with us as well. Bless this church. We ask you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.